Today we're talking about the midterm election, an election that could go either way, because neither party is close to securing a victory, or securing any part of the election for that matter. Now, some people are worried that one of the biggest American exports in 2018 will be votes. The specific concern is hacking from Russia, a country that tries harder to vote in our elections than millennials. So, first off, what happened in our last election? Well, Russia had that whole social media campaign and leaking of emails. Although, come on, how hard was it really to beat Hillary Clinton's social media team? How does your student loan make you feel? Tell us in 3 emojis or less. Well, I'd love to answer you honestly, but kids could be watching. I've read more impassioned posts from Ritz Cracker. Most people, whether you think Trump was involved or not, seem to agree that Russia's 2016 cyber campaign had 3 facets.
3 elements. Online propaganda, hacking into and exposing political organizations and individuals' emails, and targeting state election systems.
Today we're going to talk about the targeting of state election systems, because, as you can probably imagine, that's a pretty important component to states electing things. Now, before I go on, I want to explicitly say that, well, for most of the country, it generally gets viewed in the context of Trump's innocence, because it's 2018, and if we can't connect a story back to Trump, well then chances are you're probably the one person who's still watching C-SPAN. I mention this though because, despite the fact that it might sound like I'm doing this, I'm definitely trying not to delegitimize the 2016 election in any way by talking about this potential vulnerability, or say anything about Trump's innocence or guilt regarding the ongoing Russia investigation. I'm just pointing at a massive potential hole in our elections and looking at how some states are trying to resolve this issue. So, what happened in 2016?
The Department of Homeland Security identified 21 states that Russian government hackers targeted during the 2016 election. While they were clear that there was no tampering with actual votes, one state, Illinois, did have personal information of voters exposed.
That's right, they hacked the election, but they didn't change any of the votes. So what? I guess they just knew the results ahead of time. So Russia, if you hack the midterms, please, no spoilers. So what is going on? Because this sounds like Russia has found the most inefficient workaround for just paying Facebook $25 for all our data. Since that report, it was found that in 7 states specifically, the intelligence community believed the states as of January 2017 were Alaska, Arizona, California, Florida, Illinois, Texas, and Wisconsin. Which, I get trying to hack Florida, Illinois, Texas, and Wisconsin, but Alaska? The state with more caribou than people? I think Puerto Rico might have more political sway. So anyways, they hacked these states, but there was no evidence of votes being changed. So why? I mean, this was no small thing.
In 2016, the Russian government, at the direction of Vladimir Putin himself, orchestrated cyber attacks on our nation for the purpose of influencing our election. That is a fact, plain and simple.
Well, he sounds pretty confident. So let's get into this, because despite the fact that I'm formally trained in hacking as much as a mid-90s sci-fi drama, I watched a man with the charisma of a wet rag describe exactly what happened.
I know America's voting machines are vulnerable because my colleagues and I have hacked them repeatedly.
Oh man, you know in parentheses, hold for gasp was written right after that. How dramatic. Alright, so back to the story, because votes weren't changed and people weren't removed from the rolls. The trick is that
attacking vendors and municipalities could have put Russia in a position to sabotage equipment on election day, causing machines or poll books to fail and causing long lines or disruption. They could have engineered this chaos to have a partisan effect by striking places that lean heavily towards one candidate.
The threat of breaking down voting machines in key regions is what was really going to be happening. Now, I don't want to question the qualifications of our poll workers because, yes, Dolores, you've already told me so many times that your grandson is currently studying engineering at Arizona State, but I'm not sure that unplugging and replugging in the machine is going to effectively combat the Russian virus. Unfortunately, most of the juicy details are classified, and I have a current security clearance of Google search results. Alright, So Russia might have hacked the election, but it's really specific location problems. For example, Durham County, South Carolina, where the calls started flooding in from hundreds of irate North Carolinian voters just after 7 a.m. on Election Day last November. Susan Greenhalgh, a troubleshooter at a nonpartisan election monitoring group, was alarmed. Most of the complaints came from Durham, a blue-leaning county in a swing state. Now, to be fair, nothing has been concluded, so maybe the manufacturers of the voting booths are just saying, "Oh yeah, our machines were broke because of Russia, sure." Although, similar problems were found to happen in liberal districts in North Carolina, Virginia, Georgia, and Arizona. Although, I have to point out that, of these seven states that we heard Russia successfully hacked, the only state between the two lists is Arizona, a state that might only be notable for their iced tea. To refute that refute, though, the company that made the systems that failed in North Carolina and several of the other states had disclosed months earlier that they had successfully been hacked by Russia. So listen to whatever me you agree with on that one. The problem here is that in the North Carolina case, it was dozens were told that they were ineligible to vote and were turned away at the polls. Others were sent from one polling place to another, only to be rejected. More were incorrectly told that they had cast ballots days earlier. Hey, if you voted earlier, will they at least give you an "I voted" sticker? Clearly you see where my priorities lie. So now to today, because the midterms are 7 months away, so the ball is starting to roll on all sorts of measures to counter these attacks. First, what are states currently doing to protect their elections? Well, the most common solution employed by states is one that I wouldn't have expected.
The critical state of Ohio has taken an unprecedented step, calling on the National Guard's elite cyber unit to help protect the election.
That's right, we're bringing in the National Guard to protect our elections. But don't worry, the midterm elections are going on during hurricane season, so I'm sure they won't be too busy. As of right now though, our National Guard is really our main line of defense against Russia. By the midterm election, they're expecting to have 38,000 soldiers and airmen operating cyber units in 38 states. So why the National Guard? I mean, it's not like it's an absurd idea. Most reporters just seem to be regarding this kind of like you would regard seeing someone dipping fries in mayonnaise. Huh, that's different, but I could see how it would work. Well, there are two things to think about in all of this. First, the National Guard brings one inarguable benefit to the states. It's available quickly. It's an established entity that has been building its cyber defense staff, and when the alternative is years in Congress arguing over questions like, "Can you briefly describe what a computer is?" this would seem very useful. One problem is that, currently, the Defense Department has failed to maintain a required database that identifies the National Guard unit's cyber-related emergency response capabilities, according to a report by the Government Accountability Office. Well, why would we need to know which National Guardsmen are experienced in cybersecurity at the time when the National Guard is trying to build up its cybersecurity experts? We're just kind of winging it on the numbers too because of this, with the most common cited statistics saying that it's estimated that the Army National Guard and Army Reserve have more than 100,000 people with some cyber competence. Though that number represents everything from basic IT know-how to specific units trained in cybersecurity. More than 100,000 people though? That's literally almost twice as many people as Canada's current entire military. Only problem is, we're not sure which guys are the tech ones. And considering that the National Guard has 343,000 members, you can't just pick people out and assume that the majority of your choices will know what's going on. Now, having the National Guard protecting elections isn't without its controversies. First, state-level cyber assistance falls under the State Activity Duties section. States foot the bills and control the forces. Oddly enough, this might be a problem for some and a solution for others. If you want to have your elections protected, you're gonna have to pay for it. This is one of the reasons why you see 32 states letting the National Guard give them security, and not all of them. So who knows, maybe this underdog Kansas governor has a chance, because this year it was reported,
Well, the race for governor in Kansas includes a true underdog.
Meet Angus P. Woolley. One of his owners says after reading through some of the bylaws and requirements for Kansas governor, he realized that his dog could actually run for office.
Oh, man, I bet the lobbyists are already stocking up on bacon bits. I would support him wholeheartedly, except that his main platform is literally anti-squirrel. Because I know some people tend to think that they're prone to stealing things and carrying disease, but it still sounds a little speciesist. Back to the funding though, because this is not a federal program. It's just states requesting state-level cyber assistance from the National Guard, and using that assistance to protect their elections. Now to the other big problem that states are currently having with this election securing strategy, the Constitution. Because, according to critics, thanks to the US Constitution, is that state governments are responsible for keeping elections free of interference, and may activate their National Guard units for various things. Well, that sounds fine to some, but there is a constitutional fear that, just imagine what would happen if the president of whichever party you don't agree with was in charge of securing the voting machines. That would be terrible. The article goes on to say, there are limits. Governors may not, for example, station armed troops outside polling places, which would be a violation of whatever that code is. But could they, for example, station unarmed troops behind the voting booths? Well, considering the wonders our army's accomplished in creating fair elections abroad, I'm sure there will be no problem here. States currently have the constitutional right to call on Washington to help in other respects, including helping to secure networks, machines, and voter databases from theft or manipulation. So most politicians who don't have unofficial endorsements from Moscow seem to be fine with this. Now, there's one more thing we need to talk about in reference to the midterm election. The Secure Elections Act. An act in which the only short part was Section 1. Section 1, short title, 4. This act may be cited as Secure Elections Act. I don't even want to know how long this section was probably debated in Congress. Yep, this baby was just 47 pages of Kill Me Now. This act has three main things. First, the guy who wrote it must have really hated paperless voting machines. Because it mentioned it so many times, I'm thinking the guy who wrote this had a personal vendetta against trees. I would quote the document itself after reading it, but if I hear the word subsection one more time, I might smash my camera. The idea here is that voting machines have a paperless copy that can provide a receipt if the electronic machine is hacked, so you can check it.
Experts say large-scale fraud is unlikely, but if there are claims of cheating or other irregularities in Pennsylvania, that could be a big problem, because Pennsylvania is one of 15 states that uses some electronic voting machines without a paper record of the vote, which means if challenges are raised, there is no way to do a recount by hand.
Hey, Stephen, can you bring that map back for a second? Yeah, just wanted to make sure. Are you kidding me, Florida? Oh yeah, it's not like people have ever wanted a high-profile recount in your state. Ah, man. Anyways, what do they mean recount by hand? Because I'm trying to imagine someone having a huge stack of paper dumped on their desk and counting out millions of ballots without their own personal politics getting in the way. Upon recount, it turns out everyone in Florida voted for Hillary Clinton. Well, by hand is really code for...
You can hand count ballots like this as they're going through an optical scanner. What we were doing was we had three observers on one scanner machine. And one would click for Clinton, one would click for Trump, and the other one would click the undervotes. And the undervotes are when the ballot is not marked.
The second thing this act does is call for post-election audits. Not just for close races and recounts, but for all elections, because statisticians need employment. The rationale for this one is pretty obvious, just making sure nothing fishy is going on. To be clear, this act wouldn't mandate this, because in an election like Reagan against Mondale, finding out that Mondale might have won Oregon too would be a massive waste of time. Although, that guy could have used a few pity points. It simply provides financial incentives in order to check whether normal elections might be a little bit off. The final piece is the Department of Homeland Security has to let governors know Russia successfully hacked their states. That is because, in the 2016 election, the states were only notified of Russia's successful hacking attempts by the Department of Homeland Security about a year after the election. This legislation follows a pretty clear course of logic, but unfortunately, from what I've seen, it sets out to solve a problem that might not be there. Because, as I said earlier in the episode, federal and state officials say there is no evidence votes were changed. The real problem is allegedly that Russian hacking made machines break down on election day and made it look like people had already voted. So basically, when you go out to vote in this midterm, save yourself some time and drive to the nearest Republican neighborhood. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello YouTube, if you want to support nonpartisan comedic reporting, please subscribe to my channel and like below. Thank you for watching.